Well, it's a pleasure to be back with you for another GoldSeek.com Radio Nugget segment. My featured guest today, Professor Lawrence Kotlikoff from Boston University. Today's featured guest on GoldSeek Radio says the United States is bankrupt and flat broke. The U.S. is in fiscally worse shape, maybe even than Greece. It's a pleasure to welcome back to the show Dr. Lawrence Kotlikoff, a professor of economics at Boston University and author of The Clash of the Generations, as well as The Inform Act, focused on improving the welfare of every American. Welcome back, Professor Kotlikoff.
Pleasure to be with you.
In your latest page-turner, Clash of the Generations, you and Scott Burns outline an interesting 60-year government Ponzi scheme here. You show that consumption has soared while savings have dwindled for the typical American. You know, this is a peculiar anomaly. How can consumption skyrocket while savings dwindle?
You have a certain amount of income, national income, and if you consume more of it, you're going to have, by definition, less saving and therefore less money to invest because your income is can either be spent or saved. Nothing else can happen with it. So that's true for a household. It's also true for a country. And over the last 60 years, the government's been taking ever more resources from younger people, including future generations, and giving them to older generations to consume. And each generation has taken its turn at this game of take as you go. And I'm talking about transfers, not just in the form of Social Security benefits, but also Medicare benefits, Medicaid benefits, tax cuts that differentially help the elderly, just tax cuts in general that leave, you know, larger official debts to the young. So, and it's also there's been a shift in the tax structure away from taxing the income of owners of assets and towards taxing wages. Now, who's got assets? It's older people, and who's got wages? It's younger people. So, there's all these things that have been going on in many different ways that have entailed an expropriation of the young by each successive generation of the old. And my generation, the baby boomers, are about to, are standing in line to do this as well. Nobody's looking at the big picture, which is the magnitude of the burden of the bills for our children. Because most of the bills are off the books. Most of the bills we can't see because they've been labeled in a way to keep them off the books in accounting that would make Enron or Bernie Madoff blush. So you have enormous liabilities to pay for Social Security benefits, for Medicare benefits, Medicaid benefits, for defense spending. We have to, pay for the government's military in the future. We've got all kinds of expenditures that we have to pay for, and we also have all kinds of taxes that are coming due, but the taxes as projected by the CBO are $205 trillion short of the revenues as projected by the CBO when you value everything in the present. So we've got a $205 trillion fiscal gap based on the CBO's Congressional Budget Office's own projections released last October. The official debt's only $12 trillion. So we're hiding almost all of the liabilities net of the taxes to cover those liabilities with this bookkeeping that we're doing and the failure to do fiscal gap and generational accounting, which the Inform Act would require. So we're running a Ponzi scheme. Yeah, we're broke. We're probably in worse shape than Greece. Yeah, we're far worse shape than Detroit. Social Security by itself is in far worse shape than Detroit's pension system. And nobody's looking at that picture except some members, some brave members of Congress come along every so often and they start talking about it. And then they might propose something and not get reelected. But this is generational theft, pure and simple. We always say that we love our children and we care the most about our children, but we seem to hate everybody else's children. We have to understand in this country that our children are everybody's children. In other words, your child is my child, or my child is your child when it comes to the education system, when it comes to the healthcare system, when it comes to how much taxes we're going to leave the next generation. We're in this together, and we have to start seeing other people's children as our children. It's got to be our kids are us, not Toys R Us.
we have to think about the work environment that they'll be facing, because you covered healthcare, education, but we're seeing just an erosion in the quality of employment available to graduating students, whether it be high school, college, graduate school, underemployment, if you will. Any comments?
Yeah, no, it's horrible. I know so many college graduates who are doing jobs that would be unheard of for a college grad to be doing if they can find any job whatsoever, if they're not employed for a year. So it's a really, people have gone to really excellent schools and paid a lot of money out of their own pocket or their parents' pocket. So we're suffering, we're facing very intense competition from folks across the oceans in different countries, not just China, but really we're competing with people all over the world in a way that wasn't the case, because the internet able to do business abroad, to import goods that are produced abroad at a cheaper price, or to hire engineering, computer software engineering, whatever, over abroad. But we also have competition with human automation via the form of smart machines. I say human automation because humans have developed the software code that is now being embedded in smart machines, which is replacing humans. And there's very few things you can think of, apart from maybe from a massage you can get from a machine quite well. There are very few things you can think of that a machine can't do. It can shoot our enemies. It can take their purchases. It can, collect tolls on the highway. It can drive our cars shortly. It'll deliver our packages via drone or whatever. That's all coming. In the past, we had technological change, which didn't seem to be so substitutable for humans. But this form of robot technology, smart machine technology, seems to be able to directly compete with humans. So, yeah, the fact that we've got that, those two things on the plate, the fact that we're under-educating our children, we're not seriously investing in their education, we're wasting trillions on, or at least, probably at least over a trillion in wars that obviously are not winnable, that have been a total waste of money and lives and bodies. I mean, just a total disgrace to have spent 10 years in Iraq and then have that entire military fall apart in 10 minutes. Same thing's happening, probably will happen in Afghanistan. And think of all the young men and women who sacrificed their lives and bodies for a good cause, but it was poor leadership at the top for somebody's prestige. George Bush wanted to say he was a top military commander. Well, let him go fight and get maimed for life. He didn't do that with no real plan to win. It was a cowardly thing to leave our kids in Afghanistan with no real plan to win. So, and this kind of cowardly behavior by older men who don't have their own kids or their own lives at stake, and we saw that in Vietnam. I think when we commit our military, we need to, and the cost of that military, human otherwise, material, we should know what we're doing and have a game plan for winning, or pull out as soon as we figure out we can't win.
You raise so many interesting points here. For instance, you talk about the replacement of jobs by smart technology, smartphones. We find it everywhere. There's smart washers, dryers, microwave ovens. I was in a friend's car the other day. Thing was talking and giving instructions. I mean, it's just a remarkable situation. But you're right. You know, it is replacing jobs. Maybe you could tell folks why this is different from the classical John Henry, the hammer in his hand versus the railroad pneumatic drill there. Why is it different this time? I mean, could there really be a revolution of machines and robotics and smart technologies that causes an employment vacuum?
You know, it may be the combination of the technology coming on board and other products not coming on board that people can actually that need a lot of people or that don't have a lot of competition to make those products. So, you know, we've had a lot of technological improvement in agriculture, and it led to an enormous reduction in the workforce in agriculture, but people were able to find other jobs, maybe because they weren't competing with so many people from abroad. In effect, the transportation costs and the communication costs have come down so much. But also, you know, if you think about the horse and buggy that gave way to the car, think about a taxi back when we had horses and carriages. There was a driver in the horses, right, in the buggy. And that was, okay, then the taxi comes along, the car comes along, there's still a driver, different means of transportation, but there's still a driver. Now we're going to have a driverless car. So we're going to have driverless taxis. That's going to put all the taxi cab drivers and all the Uber, whatever it's called, drivers out of business. Can't say that we didn't have smarter machines back in 1880 when, you know, we got put in a, or when we developed the railroad, when that first was invented, that wasn't a, in effect, a smart machine that was going to take away a lot of jobs. It did. But other things came along. We now have, you know, you kind of think about if machines can do everything, what can people do that the machines can't do except hold hands?
You're right. Many of those jobs were lost in the horse and buggy, and the buggy whip, I think, is a classic example. But, you know, it did spark an industrial revolution. Are we going to have a society filled with programmers that program and maintain machines?
Because I'm actively doing research on this where, you know, we economists try and write down models and then not just static, but we look at what happens through time. And one of the things that happens is that when we introduce these smart machines, this technology, well, the programmers first get paid a whole lot because this technology can now be used and has a lot of uses so that they get a big return. But then when all that code gets embedded, you suddenly don't need so much programmers, as many programmers as anymore. Because think about Big Blue, that computer that has become the best chess player in the world. It doesn't have to get any better to beat forever every human on the planet, whoever comes along. We don't need an even better Big Blue. We've already built it. It's there forever. And so the computer programmers will likely suffer a big drop in their wages in the future, but there'll be some hire just to maintain the code, but the old code is going to be competing with the new programmers. The other thing to say here is that when people don't have jobs, when younger people are put out of jobs or they're put into lower paying jobs, they can't save as much, so they can't accumulate the material wealth that they would otherwise have accumulated. So if you kind of model saving and investment and what we call capital formation in the context of this kind of generational problem arising from technological change, where the older people kind of reap the reward, the return to this investment in robots, and the younger people reap lower wages, well, the younger people aren't there to, in effect, buy the output of these machines, and through time, there's less material wealth in the economy, and people in the long run can actually end up worse off. Everybody can end up worse off in the simulations, even though the technology is better, because there's less material wealth that's been accumulated, less capital around for people to work with. So we can simulate this entire process of technological change, making everybody worse off through time, except the initial owners of the technology who benefit, initial inventors. So, you know, the key question about the technology is, aren't these new cars terrific? They can drive themselves, blah, blah, blah. But the second question is, who's going to have any money to buy those cars if nobody has a job? And these are two very interconnected questions, and when we simulate the interconnection between those questions, you can end up with a society that's actually worse off on balance forever. So, you know, economists aren't called the dismal scientists for nothing. But it's very simple to get this kind of result. I wrote a paper with a professor at Columbia named Jeff Sachs. He's pretty well known, much more famous than me. There's a paper that's on my website at kotlikoff.net that you can find under articles that shows the math of this happening and simulates it, and doing a more elaborate version of that with some other people, including Jeff.
I'll look forward to reading that article, and I hope our listeners will as well. Very interesting topic, but I'd like to shift over here to another topic you bring up in your latest book here, bestseller. You go on to note that the middle class has been eviscerated, and we're seeing signs of this, you know, almost everywhere. from the recent foreclosure deluge, which I think hit the middle class and working classes the hardest, as well as in EBT debit and food stamp card programs, 47 million participants. But perhaps nowhere else does it seem to be showing up than in real inflation-adjusted income levels. And we've already touched on that a bit, but Americans earn less on average than they did decades ago. You seem to have some idea of a solution here. What's it going to take to get people better paying jobs?
Well, we have to get our fiscal house in order so that we don't leave astronomical bills to our kids. That's going to take comprehensive health care reform, not having a Medicare system that's going broke, a Medicaid system that's going broke, Obamacare system's about to probably explode in costs when employers shut down, send their employees over to get Obamacare, and they realize that it's a lot cheaper to get it, to pay a penalty, a small penalty, and not cover their workers. It's cheaper to ship them over to Obamacare and where they can get these subsidies. So Obamacare is likely to explode in costs. And then we've got employer-based health care, which the premiums for that are tax-free. So a larger and larger share of our compensation is not being hit by taxation because it's coming in the form of premium payments for these insurance policies, which is basically going into the pockets of the medical industry for procedures and medications that aren't making us any healthier than people are spending. Countries are spending a whole lot less on healthcare. So the Purple Health Plan at thepurpleplans.org, you can take a look. That is a plan for having a basic health insurance policy for every American, done in a way that won't drive us broke, that won't still entail private provision, that won't allow anybody to discriminate against people with pre-existing conditions. It's a very simple postcard-length fix, which a number of Nobel laureates have endorsed. There's a Social Security solution there, which involves freezing the existing system, which is 32% underfinanced and a complicated nightmare. I have a company called Maximize. I have a software company. We have a program called Maximize My Social Security, which I've had three engineers working on for years to get exactly correct all the details of the Social Security system. It's actually more complicated than the entire federal income tax, the Social Security system. So you need extremely smart software to figure out what to do with it. I write a column every week on the PBS NewsHour site about Social Security and answering questions, and just amazing. You could not make a system more complicated. You could have Russian bureaucrats could not come up with anything. We need to fix the tax system. There's this proposal there at thepurpletax.org. But you also, there's another proposal I wrote up called the commonsensetax.org. So there we have to fix education. We have to, we're not spending enough on the teachers. The classroom sizes are too large. We have to come up, use technology there to our advantage to get the best lectures remotely in front of every single kid in the country, because kids aren't getting a solid education. And we have to work hard on vocational training for the kids who want to move in that direction. We have to follow some of the lead of what Germany and Switzerland are doing. They don't have the kind of unemployment problems. We should look at how they're educating people and how they're training kids, and we should just follow exactly what they're doing because somehow they're getting it right in this day and age. The environmental, we need to have we're leaving a climate that has huge potential risks and costs to our kids, which we're facing up to. So we need to have a carbon tax and take the lead in keeping the world from going over a tipping point with respect to climate change and global warming. I think nobody knows for sure what the deal is there, including the top scientists, but the top scientists all agree, well, virtually all of them agree, that we're close to a tipping point and that things are getting, and we have to realize that this is, we're going to leave enormous bills, a climate that's that's extremely dangerous and hostile, and an undereducated next generation. Is that the American dream? And yeah, and the wages of American workers today, apart from these fringe benefits, in real dollars are no higher on average, according to the Bureau of Labor Statistics, than they were in 1965. That right there is a statement about the end of the American dream. It's just, it's not, maybe it's happened.
No, exactly. And I think you really hit on some important topics there. You know, modeling our education system on those which are working and those that are getting results. Take a look at China. You mentioned Germany and Switzerland. China, they're getting results. We are up against the world when it comes to education, and we've got to start preparing people with a little bit more, our students with a little bit more than just feel good, warm, fuzzy information. They need an arsenal, a toolkit to go to work. And you suggest that no brokerage account is safe. I found this article fascinating. You published at least two on the topic.
I'm writing a third one today, so it'll come out shortly. In the aftermath of the Madoff scandal and Madoff's the failure of Madoff's brokerage account, the insurance entity called CIPIC, the Securities Investors Protection Corporation, which is basically a front for a bunch of Wall Street firms, they own and operate CIPIC. They were supposed to make good on their insurance commitments to all the Madoff victims. Well, there are a lot of Madoff victims. And if you multiply $500,000, which is kind of the amount that probably on average that CIPIC people lost, you know, far, far more than $500,000, which is what CIPIC was promising to pay. But for years, they had been collecting premiums from companies like Goldman Sachs of $150 a year for all the brokerage accounts that Goldman Sachs has, $150 a year from J.P. Morgan for all the thousands, whatever, hundreds of thousands of brokerage. Yeah, $150. So they were running, CIPIC was running a scam itself, an insurance scam, telling everybody that there was this insurance. Then Madoff goes under. Then people turn and say to CIPIC, give us, you know, we've lost this amount of money. Some of it was beyond $500,000. Give us $500,000 that you promised. CIPIC turned around and said, they said to themselves, I'm sure, we don't have the money to cover this. So let's come up with some way to keep from paying. So what they came up with was the idea that if you had put money into the account and taken out over time more than you put in, which is, if you think about it, if I put in, let's say, $200,000 today and I let it grow, or maybe, you know, over the next 10 years, I put in $20,000 a year, I save, okay? I save in a brokerage account, and I let it grow. Maybe I'm now, I do this when I'm in my 30s. Now I'm in my 70s, I'm retiring. I've got an account that can be quite large because of compound interest. And that's really what we invest for, to be able to take out more than we put in, right? Why else would we invest? So we take out our money, we spend it, okay? We now face two things from CIPIC. When we go and ask for the five, maybe we take out, you know, a third of our money and we leave the rest in there. So basically all our retirement savings is left in that account. It goes under. CIPIC can't cover. CIPIC declares it to be a Ponzi scheme, which they can do with really any fraud, any brokerage account that goes under, they can claim it was a Ponzi scheme. It's pretty easy to do that because there's no clear definition of a Ponzi scheme. You can even argue that the Madoff was not a Ponzi scheme based on its overall operations. But they call, anyway, so they can declare it a Ponzi scheme. If you took out, if a third of your money that you took out exceeded what you put in, which it should over a long period of time, you're a net winner, according to CIPIC, and therefore you're not owed a penny on the $500,000 of insurance. So you might have lost, you know, $1 million, $2 million. And because you took out more than you put in, you get back not a penny. But the story gets actually worse than that. Whatever you took out in the prior 6 years, because if your brokerage is located in New York, headquartered in New York City or New York State, sorry, you're subject to New York State law according to CIPIC. So according to New York State law, CIPIC can go after you for every dollar that you took out over the prior 6 years before the fraud was discovered, and sue you for that to the extent that that amount is less than your total withdrawals over your entire course of your over the 40 years that you put the money in, net of any contributions you put in. So if you, well, let me give you an example here. If you put in, you know, $200,000 four or five decades ago, and it grew to maybe $3 million, which is, could easily happen, given compounding and historic rates of return on the stock market, if you thought that money was safe, you took out the money, maybe you took out $1 million, and so you're viewed as a net winner to the tune of $800,000. Your brokerage account goes under. You had a your statement after you'd taken out, you know, what this money. Your statement read that you still had $1.5 million in that, as a balance. Well, you go and ask for $500,000 to cover the $1.5 million loss. You get nothing. Furthermore, since you've taken out $1 million over the past 6 years, they can sue you for $800,000. They can sue you for all your withdrawals over the past 6 years, up to what's called your the difference between what you put in over the lifetime of the account and what you took out, which from my assumption here was $800,000. So they can sue you for up to $800,000. So you won't get paid the insurance that they promised you, and you'll also get turned around and get sued for $800,000. So you've lost your entire retirement savings, and now they're suing you to take your house or your vacation home. This is not insurance. This is risk generation. This is an insurance scam, which is putting everybody who has a brokerage account in the entire country at risk. If you take any money, if you do what every investor hopes, which is to make more money than you put in, take it out and spend it, you can't sleep at night for the next 6 years, because if you spend that money and it turns out that within 6 years, some fraud is declared in that brokerage account, in that brokerage firm, it doesn't have to be, you know, connected to your specific account or your specific broker, just has to be the brokerage firm goes under, because maybe the broker down the hall in that company was the bad apple. Anyway, SIPC can come and sue you back for every dollar you took out and spent over the last 6 years. So this is why I wrote a column called Close Your Brokerage Account, and because it's not safe. It's just, I wouldn't put a penny in a brokerage account at this point. There is a bill in front of Congress which would fix this problem, and I discussed that in the columns that I wrote. And we need to get anybody who's got a brokerage account today is not safe. They should take their money out, not spend it for 6 years to be perfectly safe. And then they can have the opportunity to spend it without risk of being clawed back by SIPC. You don't know who the brokerage is going to hire in the next 2 years, 3 years, 5 years, if you take your money out today. But over that entire time, if they go under because of a fraud, you're liable for every penny you took out today of your account. So this is what SIPC has done to save Wall Street from paying its the claims that were rightfully should have been paid to the victims of the Madoff fraud. So we've all been made into Madoff victims, the entire population, by SIPC.
You know, it's almost reminiscent of what we saw there with Cyprus and, of course, the Polish pension scam, where they lost about half of their pension. I mean, there seems to be all this legislation behind the scenes that's putting those who used to be insulated from this type of threat of confiscation, if you will, and we can, for the most part, we're all on the hook now, is what it looks like. Do you agree?
It's not just the people who, you know, the Madoff victims were scammed twice by Madoff and then by SIPC. Large numbers, and very few of them actually got any recovery from SIPC. The lawyer for SIPC, the lawyers there have been, you know, taking huge amounts of money as payment for their services. They should be doing their work pro bono. It's not just that, but they've changed the way that specific handle the Madoff case, was they got the law changed in their favor to produce this definition of what they owe to and who has to repay money that was taken out. In effect, they call anybody who took money out in the 6 years before the fraud was discovered a thief. They're calling them a thief, and then they're going back and suing them for stealing money. That's what they're being accused of stealing money. It's double jeopardy. You could not only lose your entire retirement, you could not only not get paid your insurance, but then you get called a thief and get sued for a huge sum of money that you took out and you spent maybe on your mother's nursing home or your kid's education or you gave to charity. Now you're being sued for, in this example, $800,000, basically, or maybe it could be a smaller amount. It doesn't matter. So no brokerage account today is safe until we get this bill passed.
It sounds like we can't trust, as investors, our financial system, and you can't trust your brokerage account. Our currency is losing purchasing power, and the price of goods and services continue to skyrocket. Would you agree, then, that there's somewhere there must be an alternative investment class with some appeal against these corrosive powers, one of them obviously precious metals?
Well, I think precious metals are, you know, one way to try and hedge your bets. So I think everybody should have some precious metals in their portfolio, whether you want to, you know, load up a huge fraction of your portfolio. I'm not sure I would advise that. There are other countries that you can invest in. For example, you could invest in the bonds of Chile, which is a very well-run economy with led by a lot of economists in terms of the top cabinet positions. You could invest in the government bonds of New Zealand or Australia or Canada. These are countries that are all fiscally solvent. You can diversify holdings of stocks around the world, and you can try and do that outside of a brokerage account. You can try and do that with a mutual fund company that has a third-party custody where you're pretty darn sure that those securities that you've bought through your brokerage, through your mutual fund, actually are there. If you use, for example, Vanguard, and they invest, I think they probably use a somebody like State Street Bank, which is solely as custodian company, then you're pretty well assured that the money's safe. Or you could just try and buy securities directly and hold the certificates. You know, in effect, put the money under your mattress, put the stock certificates or the bond certificates under your mattress and not use a broker. Because you're suffering, you know, if you put money in a brokerage account, you cannot spend it for 6 years when you take it out. Because it can all be clawed back. Every penny you took out can be clawed back net of whatever you put in. And we hope and pray that that's a big number when you invest. And the older you are, the longer you've invested in a brokerage account, the more at risk you are. And then for a given length of investment periods, the better your broker has done, the more you've accumulated in that account. And therefore, if you take your money out, the more risk you're going to face. So the people that everybody should be closing their brokerage account immediately, and the ones who have the most to worry about are the ones who've been in the longest in these brokerage accounts or have done the best in terms of rate of return.
Well, Professor Kotlikoff, we can't thank you enough today for just a very informative, enlightening discussion. You've given us so much food for thought. It's going to take us all, I'm sure, days, if not weeks, to digest all of this. We also appreciate the fact you may work around ivory towers, but you make time for the rest of us. So we wish you the best and continued success, sir.
Well, listen, my pleasure. And none of us are really in ivory towers. If we're really, you know, economists are supposed to be trying to understand the real world, and we better be in it to try to understand it. So I do, you know, there are some economists who are in ivory towers, but most people are trying to really understand what's going on. So I think if economists were running our country, we wouldn't be in these kinds of problems. We have a government without a single PhD in economics, and Congress, as far as I understand, the people that are advising the Obama administration right now in economics, you know, I've got no real credentials for doing this. I've got no top-level economists in the administration at this point. Anyway, great talking to you. We'll be in touch tomorrow, okay?